Independent and so thrilled to have so many people here for an afternoon talk. It could be an afternoon tea, but it's an afternoon talk with Dr. Michael Thompson. Do not forget that he will be back again tonight for the very popular, very important talk on the pressured child. Now, I know living in Singapore, that's not an issue for any of you. But if it is by chance, please come back tonight. I am the proud father of two boys, and I'm gonna tell just a 30-second story about the first time that I invited Michael to the International School of Prague. And my wife usually tells this story, but I'm gonna tell it quickly for her. And being a good school head, I thought maybe save a little money, but at the same time, Michael and I had become friends in another organization and tennis partners, and so I invited him to stay at our house. And both of our boys were at home at that time. And he said, well, I normally don't like to stay at heads' houses because I get a lot of questions about their children. And
I didn't say that.
And but it sounds good for the story.
I know.
He actually didn't say that. I told my wife she couldn't ask any questions because we, you know, had him in the house, and you know, just I said to Kate, just don't ask any questions about Sean and Matthew, okay? Just he's our guest. And so he arrived and she was like had duct tape on her mouth. And any of you who have engaged Michael in conversation know that he asks and asks and asks, and he's great at asking questions. So now he is asking Kate about Sean and Matthew, and she doesn't know whether or not she's allowed to answer the questions or not. But he is a psychologist, and he managed to get a lot out of her, and at the second time, she had her questions ready. So he is a wonderfully gracious person and a great speaker, and we're thrilled to have him back at SAS. And so here he is, once again, Dr. Michael Thompson.
Thank you, Robert. I see a few familiar faces. How many of you are the parents of boys? Yeah. How many boys 0 to 5, birth to 5 years old? Okay, little boys. 5 to 10. 10 to 15. That's where the action is today. 15 to 20. 20 and older. What are you doing here? What are you hoping for? You're just as a review course. You're gonna be filled with memories. Somebody with a little boy, tell me if I could answer the question you have, the question that brought you out this afternoon about your boy younger than 5, what would you ask me? What worries you? What perplexes? Oh, I'm gonna give a talk. I'm just gonna do some questions of you first. What worries you about a boy? A little boy. You had no worries? Come on. Please. Should you redshirt them? That is, hold them back before kindergarten. Yeah, I have a chapter in my book, It's a Boy, about this. how close is your son to the cutoff date? Does everybody know what redshirting means? Okay, it means holding a boy back and giving him if his birthday is quite close to the cutoff, and he's gonna be the youngest in kindergarten, for developmental reasons, you hold them back. The redshirting term comes from college football in the United States, and it's about not playing your first year so you can keep your eligibility later. But we now use it, the sports analogy for little boys. So tell me your name and how did you resolve the question of, did you hold your boy back or did you let him go on?
I didn't hold him back, but I probably should have.
You didn't hold him back and you probably should have. And tell me why. What? All three. You now wish you'd held all three of them back. Because why? They might have been a little more mature. How do they do academically?
They're doing okay.
Okay. But you wonder what would have been the impact if you'd given him more time. So I take the position, and it's a boy, when in doubt, keep them out. That is, hold them back. Because kindergarten is the new first grade. The requirements for reading and writing are often very burdensome to boys who don't have so much maturity. We use kindergarten, used to be a year of play and group formation and just getting adjusted to school. And the requirements for reading didn't really come till first grade. But now the requirements for reading and even writing have moved down into kindergarten. And parents are frankly panicking about you know, my son's not reading in kindergarten. It's very worrisome to me. You know, Norway didn't used to start school until age 8. Were you aware of that? You're aware? And Norwegian kids who went to school to age 8 are behind other countries for about 6 months, and they catch up. And there's something to be learned from that. In America now, we think everything must start earlier, and we're pushing our kids earlier and earlier and earlier. And of course, it makes many boys feel overwhelmed by school and developmental demands that they can't keep up with, and they get the problem is that many of them get discouraged that they develop behavior problems early on because they're overwhelmed. I had a mother who told me that her kindergarten son, she'd gotten him a reading tutor. He was 5. And I said, really? Were there signs, worrisome signs? She said, no, I just got him a reading tutor. It's a private school in the United States. And I wonder, what does a 5-year-old think about reading when his mother has gotten him a tutor right away? What's the message, and what does he understand about reading? What is reading, then? Is it a thing of pleasure? No, not. So I'm always interested in getting little boys to love school. And when you do pressing up against their developmental abilities, of course, that reduces their ability to love school. There was another hand up here of a younger than 5. Yes, please. I'm going to get you. I'm going to get to you the microphone. Yeah.
So this is similar to the earlier question, but I have a 2.5-year-old.
Yes.
I like having him at home, and he seems to like it just fine.
Yes.
And we don't really. I mean.
You don't do much. You hang out.
Yeah.
In kind of Norwegian way.
We're very Norwegian.
Yeah.
And so I feel like a certain type of pressure, though, to be sending him somewhere. And I mean, I don't think he's ready, because usually when we do go somewhere, like the class, he runs for the door. So I just don't, can I wait for a while and just let him hang out?
Oh, but you're working on numbers and letters all the time. Why don't you tell me your name?
Mary.
Mary, what are you doing with this time? You know I'm teasing you.
Yes.
All right. What are you doing with this time that you're spending with him?
We play, and we go to the pool, and he eats snacks and takes a nap.
Takes a
sees
nap.
Sees friends.
Sounds pretty good.
Yeah.
And does he have any, do you have any kind of play group?
Occasionally. And there are people who live in our condo with similar age, older, younger, and they all tend to
right.
play for and a little while.
And he plays with other kids.
Yes.
And he plays up and he plays down a little bit.
Yes.
And how's that going?
It's going well. Yeah.
Well, so you know what I'm going to say.
Yes,
here.
I do.
Look, the research is that for children who come from disadvantaged homes homes where parents are pressed for time or afflicted by the stresses of poverty, who have the television on constantly, who can't give the time to games and conversations, and then they can't talk to their children. And there are all of these studies that show that children from these kinds of homes are helped by early intervention like Head Start in the United States and stuff like that, and early preschool efforts. And President Obama's pushing pre-kindergarten. The mayor of New York City, Bill de Blasio, is pushing pre-kindergarten. And they have in mind children from disadvantaged families, and the research is we need to get them into situations where they're being stimulated and talked to and responded to. And, but if your son is being talked to and playing games with you and you're hanging out and you're doing things and he has some social contact with other kids and you're having fun and you don't feel as if he is ready, relax. Think Norwegian. Okay? Because there's going to be plenty of school. And early reading, early mastery of numbers, early reading, early reading predicts early reading. When you are an early reader, you are an early reader. It does not predict genius. It does not predict great school performance. It means you were developmentally ready to read earlier. Okay? I mean, I'm just reading a biography of Abraham Lincoln, arguably, certainly our greatest president. He learned to read at 7 years old. He had no one to teach him reading because he had an illiterate mother. And those were the old days, you know. We understand that. That was 1800. But when he started to read, he was an absolutely voracious, unstoppable reader. And the idea that we can turn all of our kids into voracious, unstoppable readers is a faulty idea. But the idea that getting them to read earlier will produce later academic genius is an idea that has almost no foundation in research. So don't panic about your boy. I was a late reader, and I've written 9 books. My friend Ned Hallowell was an even later reader, and he's written 18 books. 5 to 10, your biggest concern. What brought you out? If you have, yes, please. Thank you. Tell me your name.
Namrata. And I have a 5-year-old.
Yes.
And everyone is constantly telling him, don't cry, be brave.
Yes.
Every time he falls down or he doesn't like something and there's tears in his eyes.
Yes,
yes. He hears it from everyone.
Yes.
Be brave, don't be a girl.
Does he hear it from you, Namrata?
No, he doesn't hear it from me or my husband.
Your husband, that was my next question. You answered it for me.
But he hears it from other family members. He hears it from other kids in the playground. He definitely hears it from his peers in school.
Yeah. Yeah, this is the shaping of masculinity. And every boy, I'm going to show you a clip from my film, but it won't include this. I will ask a group of boys, what does it mean to be a man? And a group of 8-year-old boys will say, you can't cry, you have to be tough, you have to kick ass, you can't cry, you can't cry, you can't cry.
Yeah.
Okay, so they absorb the lesson. And I say, as the narrator in the movie, I say, you know, it puts a third grade boy into conflict when he says, you can only be a boy if you don't cry, and he knows he's already cried twice that day.
Yeah.
Boys cry a lot. And I work at an all-boys school, and actually, I find boys cry more in an all-boys school with less shame, because nobody's gonna say to them, the girls see that you came crying like a girl, right? If you're in a boys school, you cry like a boy, and you've seen other boys cry. And so you stop giving each other a hard time about it. But this is the shaping of masculinity. And Namrata, all you can do, if you'd said your husband was on the other side and he was saying, don't cry, I was going to have you go after him.
Oh, no.
But the fact that he's relaxed about his son, if he sees his father has a full emotional life, if he sees that other boys have a full emotional life. That's what we want for boys. What you can't do with boys, when you know they want to cry or they start to cry, what you can't do is say to them, it's okay to cry. What happens when a boy starts to cry and you say, oh, it's okay to cry? What do? They stop crying. Absolutely. The moment you say it's okay to cry, they feel self-conscious about their crying and they stop. So I'm the psychologist for a boys' school, and boys very often cry in my office. And I trained myself. When I was in co-ed schools, girls would cry and I hand them Kleenex, they keep crying. If I hand a boy Kleenex, he stops crying. So I learned to stop handing boys a Kleenex. And I just let them cry. I sit very still and I just let them cry. Because I don't want to put them into any conflict. They need to cry, they can cry with me. And I wait until the hand comes out, starts going around, right? But these are the lessons that boys learn starting at 3 or 4. To be a boy means to be tough. To be a boy means to be strong. And it puts every man into some conflict about his feelings of shame and inadequacy, which are an inherent part of human life, an inescapable part of human life. You cannot be a human being without at times feeling shame and inadequacy. We know of the sort of the basic human feelings, work done on what are the basic expressions that are found in every human society on Earth. And of course, anthropologists went and tried to find societies in isolated parts of the Amazon jungle and find societies that never had contact with any other society and then see whether the emotional life of humans are the same and what are the basic set of 7 human emotions. And shame and a feeling of inadequacy of looking down at your feet and the shoulders slumped over is part. It's one of the basic human repertoire. You can't get through life without feeling those feelings, and they're lousy feelings to feel. Well, they're lousy feelings to feel, but to feel that if I feel embarrassed or ashamed, then I am not going to be a man, then I won't be a strong boy, is an additional burden that boys carry. So I'll tell a story about my son, Will, who cried more easily than other boys when he was little. He was more anxious, and he tended to unravel and have a meltdown, as his teachers described. Will meltdown. And he came to me in 4th grade, and he said, Dad, I hate it that I still cry at school. So I'd written a book called Protecting the Emotional Life of Boys, right? And I thought, this is a test for me. What do I say? And no matter what I said to my son was, really? I said, I think you cry a lot less than you did in 2nd grade. And he put his shoulders back and he said, yeah, that's true. And he walked off feeling pretty good, right? Because he felt stronger than his 2nd grade self, right? He felt reassured that he was growing up. And my son now lives in New York and he doesn't cry very often. He got out of college, moved to New York, got a job. This all happened the last year. I'm very, very proud of him. That he's mastered the big city and gotten a new job and is doing very well. And he doesn't cry. He's 24. So sometime between 4th grade and 24, he found that he didn't have to cry as much. But I hope he's still capable of it when life deals him sadness or grief. And I think what you can say to your son is, sometimes in life you have to cry. Don't say it when he's crying. Say it later, you know? There's some things in life worth crying about. And also, there's some things in life not worth crying about, right? The trivial, and we have to teach children not to fall apart over little things and be resilient. And that's lessons that we teach. But we don't want to burden boys unnecessarily with the idea that the the emotions that they naturally feel are in some way suggesting that they are not going to be strong, capable men. And we say, Dan Kinlan, my co-author, and I say in Raising Cain, throughout a boy's life, you're going to teach him that emotional courage is courage. Because boys think only physical courage is courage. You know, risk-taking, characters in movies, tough guys. But emotional courage is courage. And when you can praise him for his endurance, for his perseverance in the face of discouragement, for being able to bear disappointments, then you are showing him that he's manifesting courage in ways that he may not have thought were necessarily strong or masculine. And by doing that, you are praising him for strength that he may underappreciate in himself, because boys only talk about who's good at football or who's, but you know, athletic prowess. And that's a way of broadening out a boy's emotional life and his own self-definition of what is courageous. 10 to 15. Yes. You don't get to have a question? All right, I'm going to get you the microphone. 10 to 15. Tell me your name.
I have two boys, Juliet.
Juliet. So can I make a prediction?
Yes, go ahead.
You're going to talk to me about disorganization?
Sure.
No, no.
I have two boys that are very different, emotionally different.
Yes, emotionally different.
Hardwired.
How old are they?
One is 14, one is 12.
Yeah.
And the 12-year-old, since birth, was the glass is half empty.
Yeah.
Always been.
Yep.
And it seems like no matter what I do,
yep,
his glass is not going to be full.
Yep.
And I could beat it. And like talking about the crying issue, he's the overcrier. It's hard to find, yep, the balance. Like, well, you know, you just spill the milk. You don't have to have a complete meltdown about,
right,
the milk.
Right. Just spill milk.
Yet it's okay to cry. So that's a hard.
Yeah.
That's a hard balance for me to play.
Does his 14-year-old brother give him a hard time about it?
A little, probably. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, yeah. He's older and probably.
Good.
I would say, but for the younger one, he always feels like he just always has this chip on his shoulder.
Yes.
I don't know how to break that.
You can't.
Him. Yeah.
Awesome. You can't. there are some people who are born in this life with a slightly depressive cast.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. He does.
A. Milne knew this when he created the character of Eeyore.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right?
Yeah.
That's what's brilliant about, to me, what's brilliant about the cast of characters, mm-hmm, in Milne, that he included the classic, slightly depressive, this isn't going to be any good, I'm not going to have any fun.
Mm-hmm.
And so how do you handle it, Juliet, when you've got to...
I keep pushing him to do, you know, just getting him out the door is a challenge. So
yep.
I just push, get him out the door, and then he's fine.
Yeah, great.
Typically he's fine.
All right.
I might hear about it later. I kind of go, what's the blowback going to be? And sometimes there is, sometimes there isn't. But I just keep making him go. And then he, despite how much he fights me on it, you know, and just, you're the worst mom ever. And but then eventually...
He goes. And so... He needs.
I keep trying to give him more and more positive experiences and just keep, right, trying to create that for him, but sometimes it's positive, sometimes it's.
All right.
It's not.
What I would do is maximize the pushing and minimize the preaching.
Yeah.
Okay?
Right.
Because I'm doing this for your own good. I'm doing,
right,
this for your own good. Don't,
right,
you understand? I'm,
right,
just really fine, isn't it? Aren't,
right,
you enjoying this? And he's going, no, 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 no.
Right.
So with a kid like this, you need to say, I'm sorry, you have to do this.
Mm-hmm.
Regrettable,
mm-hmm,
go.
He goes, but you're not really sorry. Why do you regret it? That's what he says.
I don't
want
to fight about it. Go.
Yeah, I was like, why,
right,
do you say you're sorry?
Minimize,
yeah,
conversation, because, okay, he wants to get into,
yeah,
a nice,
yes,
depressive debate.
Yes, he does.
In which,
yes,
you,
yes,
are assigned the role,
right,
of the unrealistic and annoying optimist.
Right.
And he gets to be,
mm-hmm,
the realist,
mm-hmm,
and mom, you don't understand, and I'm aggrieved. And all kids feel that about their parents at times. That's part of growing up, mm-hmm. is feeling that about your parents. But it's wearing on the parents.
Mm-hmm. Very.
And it's very old style to say, just do it, I don't want to talk about it. Mm-hmm. But with a kid like this, you say, I'm so sorry, I'm not sure it's going to be any fun for you, but I need you to go.
Right. Right.
Okay?
Yeah.
Yeah. Really, you know, life is full of terrible chores.
Right.
And I'd kind of join him in his depressive affect.
Okay.
And get him out the door.
Okay.
Okay? Is that helpful?
Stick on the consequences if he doesn't or no?
What?
I mean, you know, I used to be able to just physically carry him out, but obviously I can't anymore. I mean, do I have to turn on other consequences if he doesn't go? I mean, he sits in the chair, he's like, I'm not going.
Oh, okay.
So it's like, well, here's the elevator, it's here, we gotta go. So
and
say,
we have to go where to what kind of activity?
Say a barbecue.
A barbecue.
Yeah.
And, you know, where people might have fun.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
exactly.
Does he want to stay and play video games by himself?
Yeah.
And he's the 12, he's not
right,
14.
Right.
You don't feel comfortable leaving him?
Oh, there's too many times that I have. You know,
and
I mean,
what
sometimes
happens?
I'll be flexible, and he's happy as can be. He's completely thrilled. He Skypes with his friends and plays Minecraft. Couldn't be happier.
Okay. So if you feel comfortable leaving him and he's very happy, then I would only force him to go to things that you need, where you need him to be present.
Okay. I worry about the hibernation.
He's what?
I worry about the hibernation.
Does he have friends?
Yeah.
Does he like school? Is he doing well?
Okay,
I'm not worried. You haven't got me worried, Julia. You haven't got me worried at all. 15 to 20. Oh, you have a 10 to 15.
No. I know we're on to the 10 to 15.
Yeah.
But what about little boys? Do you push them out as well who are anxious? Like this week was the first week I can see my son. He's 6. In school without him clinging to me.
Yeah.
And like I couldn't see him. I avoided him all day. In the morning, and now I can finally see him, but like going to a birthday party, like his friend, even his own birthday party.
Yeah.
He's like, all these people are coming, like it's out of his comfort zone. And I'm like, it's your friends, you're gonna have fun. And
oh yeah,
and
that's
he's like,
when,
no,
when
I don't wanna go.
Somebody's really anxious.
Yeah.
A nice pep talk really helps him a lot.
I know.
Tell me your name.
Janelle.
Janelle. So you get to play the optimist, and he gets to play the anxious, and you say nothing to be anxious about. And
right,
he says, are you kidding,
helpful.
Janelle?
Yes.
Are you kidding, Mom? There's a ton to be anxious about.
So do you make him go? I mean, eventually he is fine, but there was one party I took him to, and he literally, the entire party, with all of his friends from school, stood on my leg and would not move.
All right, so he's got some social anxiety and some separation anxiety. That's fairly, he's above average anxious. Janelle, the only thing I can say to comfort you, people come up to me all the time and say, oh, Dr. Thompson, my son's very sensitive. And I say, well, what do you mean by sensitive? Well, he's very anxious. And I always say, you know, 50% of boys are of above average anxious. 50% are below average anxious. And you have an above average anxious boy. So Janelle, I can say with complete conviction, you have an above-average anxious boy.
And probably.
Now, I don't think he has a diagnosable anxiety disorder because he has a recovery period, but transitions are very tough for him. And you can say, you're going to grow stronger in this. And in the meantime, I'm sometimes going to put you in situations that are going to make you anxious. And I think you're going to need to do them to build your strength. And that's what we're about here. And I'm going to help you, okay? But I would watch very carefully to see what helps him succeed. It may be that your being there means he has to hold onto your leg, and it's helpful. It will be helpful to him when you go away. If you can make it as quick as possible. And you have to figure out what, you're gonna have to pretty much track what are the triggers for his anxiety and what are the things that elicit his strength, and help him to see those kinds of things, because he's gonna be anxious. He's above average anxious. He's never ever actually going to be a relaxed and mellow guy. Okay, so but he's gonna have to learn to manage his own anxiety. That's why I became a psychologist, right? I was way above average anxious. Most psychologists are. They're fine careers for anxious people. Almost all of my doctor friends were wildly anxious boys, okay? It motivates them to master medicine and be in control, right? And it makes them vigilant and sometimes perfectionistic. It sometimes is an enormous prod to their intellectual development. It's not always a walk in the park. And you can empathize with both. All right, we got 15 to 20? And then I'm gonna actually give a talk. Yes, Cheryl. Yeah, no, I know you.
I have three.
I know. Boys.
The other one's a girl, but I have three boys, 20. One is 18 and one's 17.
Yes.
The 20 and 18 year olds are in college and
yes.
They're delighted.
Yes.
They sleep now, they're so happy.
Yeah.
The 17 year old is a senior.
Yes.
And I am concerned.
Yeah.
That because of the stress of high school.
Yeah.
That maturity gets put on the back burner.
Yeah.
And that is my concern.
Yep. So. Yep. So, is he absolutely sure he wants to go to university next year? He's sure he wants to go to university. And once he gets in, he's gonna be fine. Has he applied early? And so he hears in 3 p.m. on December 12th, 3 a.m. Something like that. So a kid, one of the seniors told me here. She said, I'm hardly sleeping. And I said, when do you hear? And she told me, does anybody know? A parent of a senior? Oh, aren't you feeling good right now? You aren't the parent of a senior? So it'll all be, he'll either get in and it'll be fine, or he won't get in and he'll have to wait. But at some point, he's gonna relax, and given the evidence of his two older brothers, once he gets in, he's going to be fine. Yeah? Yeah, good. We watch all of this, and it makes him intensely helpless. Of course. And when you have the great American novelist John Updike wrote an early book about a teenage boy called The Centaur, and he described a teenage boy who could walk into a room and throw an atmosphere that would completely ruin everything in the family. And 16, 17-year-old boys are capable, they're really capable from 14 on, of coming in and spoiling everything with their attitude. And when that's happening, it's best to avoid them. If you can possibly tune them out, ignore them, give yourself a timeout, move to another room, because what they want is a nice fight to lift them out of their torpor and their pessimism. And there is nothing that works as well as a nice fight with your mom about your attitude. You don't provide that. Good, good. So I'm gonna give a little talk, but before that we're gonna meet a boy. And Andrew, if you will, this is from my PBS documentary, which follows boys, starts with the birth of a boy and ends with high school seniors. It's a 2-hour documentary called Raising Cain. And we're gonna visit with a 5th grade boy in Melrose, Massachusetts. We were asked the school system to give us a boy who was very hyperactive, and they were worried right on the edge of what they could handle, because the single biggest complaint about American boys is that by teachers is that they're restless, they don't focus, they're inattentive, and this boy was all of those things. And of course, we lead the world in ADHD diagnosis. 80% of the world's stimulant medication is a treatment for ADHD is prescribed by American doctors, the vast, vast majority of going to American boys. And the school system had been trying to get this boy on medication, and his mother would not permit it. So let's look at Kevin. Oops. Did I tell you we needed sound? We got sound, all right.
I like school. Some stuff are pretty fun to do. Some stuff are somewhat hard.
It's kind of hard and it's boring.
It's like hard to concentrate.
I'd probably think it's easier for girls.
It might be easier for girls because sometimes the teachers favor girls.
Draw all the triangles and show me your work.
Most of the teachers are girls, and some teachers don't like boys because they think they're like mean and nasty.
And people say like boys are like bad and girls are like so nice.
You know, it's tough being a boy in school. By ages 10 and 11, girls perform equally well as boys in math and science, and much better in reading and writing. Boys are still less emotionally mature, more physically active, and more impulsive.
Andrew?
Yes?
That's not working.
I know.
That leads many boys to conclude that school is a place where the deck is stacked against them.
All right. I'll come back.
But as we shall see, an understanding teacher can help change that attitude.
Kevin is a very charming boy.
Well, can I ask us what you're
doing? Absolutely. Maybe. I'll think about it tonight, I said. Okay. When I got a haircut one day, the next day, boy, Mr. O'Terry, you look good today. He's funny, he's energetic. I think he will be mayor of Melrose someday.
Melrose is a middle-class, mostly white community outside Boston. At the Lincoln School, Mr. O'Terry's fifth grade class has 14 boys and 5 girls. Nationally, boys account for 70% of the D's and F's given out at school.
Morgan.
It's half a rectangle.
Why the difference? Well, what's school all about? School's mostly about sitting down and listening to an adult talk.
Our formula is 1/2 times the base.
For boys like Kevin, that can be very hard to do.
6, 'cause 6 is the base, times 5, the height. Kevin and I have had challenging days. Base is 6, height is 5, 1/2 times. He does have a hard time focusing. Now, what's our formula for area of a triangle again, Kevin?
5 and 6.
What's the formula? How do we figure it out?
And when he does get distracted, it definitely takes away from what he has to get done.
Hold on.
Last year, Kevin's distractibility caused his grades to fall. He got mostly C's, and he sometimes disrupted class.
And Kevin? Kevin? Homework. Take out your homework. Max?
Kevin is a handful.
They're videotaping me drink.
Kevin may push things to an extreme, but his energetic behavior is typical for boys his age. So it's no surprise what boys say they like most about school.
Gym.
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 Recess.
I like lunch.
Snack.
That's pretty much it.
30 years ago, elementary schools offered recess twice a day. Boys got a chance to work off their physical energy. But there's only one recess at Kevin's school to make more time for classes. Some schools are even eliminating recess altogether. I believe that's a real mistake. Boys in particular need more recess, not less, to become more effective students.
Adam, you haven't read yet? Okay, hold on. I'll get to you. What's your question, Jess?
All too often, this behavior gets labeled as a disorder. Now, there's no denying that some boys do have attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. In fact, they're nearly three times more likely than girls to have ADHD. But when almost 85% of the world's stimulant medication gets prescribed to American boys, we have to ask the question, are we medicating boys because they're sick or because they're boys?
I have mixed feelings on it. As an educator, I've seen it work wonders with kids. You can see with some kids when they're not on the medication and when they are on the medication. It's very clear. As a parent, I have a different feeling about it. I don't know if I'd want my son or daughter having to take a pill every day.
What's up, Kim?
Hi, Jaden.
I think a lot of people in general, you know, don't get boys. I mean, I think they're judged right off the bat from just being a boy, especially when they're young. Just to jump the gun and say, oh, well, they're not really listening. They probably need medicine. You know, that's really not the case.
Should a boy like Kevin be medicated? In a lot of schools, he probably would be. But Kevin's parents and Mr. O'Terry are trying to make school into a place where Kevin can succeed without drugs.
5 minus 4?
I smell popcorn.
5 minus 4?
1 and 1/4.
Okay, so 1 and 1/4. Now, you have which is bigger? You have something that's bigger.
Helping Kevin is a lot of work. Every Tuesday after school, Mr. O'Terry, on his own time, provides special tutoring for Kevin and other boys.
Well, that's only the first one.
It's all right.
It was hard.
You don't have to rush through this, Kevin.
This is the first year he's had a male teacher, which I think worked out great. Kevin loves his teacher. He can relate to all these boys in the class.
This is the steps we need to take, slowly.
Today, fewer than 1 in 9 elementary school teachers in the U.S. is a man.
Now bring down the...
Attracting more male teachers might help improve boys' performance.
Kevin, let me finish talking. Adam, sit. You stop. And you stop. Kevin, you're smart enough to do that problem. You need to stop, though.
Still, it's not easy for Kevin or Mr. O'Terry. So to keep Kevin engaged, Mr. O'Terry has come up with other creative strategies.
I might see him struggling with something that we're working on in class, and his frustration level will build, and then he'll shut down, and I'll lose him for the rest of the afternoon. Or if he's disrupting the other students in class, I'll send him around the school with a note that just says, I'm on a walk.
Where are you going?
I gotta go downstairs for a sec. Because I gotta go around the building, like, because I have to, like, I don't know really why, but I have to, like walk around the building and then come back up.
Kevin gets sent on these walks a couple of times a week.
But why doesn't everyone else?
Wait, one more, because I'm lucky.
Kevin is lucky. Lucky to have a dedicated teacher like Mr. O'Terry and parents who advocate for him. So far this year, his grades reflect that. They've climbed from C's to B's. But in other communities, it's a much tougher struggle to keep boys engaged in school.
And then we go, the movie goes to the poor school in a failing inner city school in the South Bronx, where a very brilliant boy, his teacher says to his adoptive grandmother, get him out of here. He's cute, the girls are hitting on him, the boys are teasing him because he's so academic. Get him out, and the grandmother gets him to an all-boys school, a Catholic all-boys school. He takes 2 buses and a subway to get there. And his academic energy is ignited, and he's suddenly with boys who want to learn, and boys who aren't ashamed of doing well in school, who don't think that being a good student is antithetical to being masculine, which in many communities becomes a problem for bright boys. And this is not SAS, and so I don't need to show you a kid being saved from a failing school, but that's, in the United States at least, it's our boys who are doing least well in the educational system. It's our boys of color. If you're going to predict the outcome for a child in the public schools of the United States, you want a child from a middle upper middle class family, and you want a white child and a girl. And the kids who are doing least well are poor kids and kids of color and boys. And so the educational outcomes for boys are significantly worse than for girls. And it was one of the things I talked about yesterday. I'm not going to repeat that. I gave a talk, Coming to Grips with Boy Underachievement. But how to keep boys interested in school, how to keep boys engaged when they're always bumping up against the system is a question that every school confronts. The underachieving boy, the disengaged boy, the disorganized boy, and parents often panic about these. I just want to do a little survey. I think I have enough. I don't have a lot of men in here, but I have enough just to do a little bit of a survey. So I'm just going to ask men. Tell me your name, sir.
Sumit.
Yeah. When did you become an organized, take the initiative, do everything in school, really come to grips with school, get your act together in school kind of boy, Sumit? High school. When in high school?
Probably ninth grade.
Ninth grade. Thank you. Your name, sir? Lance, yes?
Yeah,
tenth or 11th grade. Thank you. You, sir, in the back. It's Jim, right?
Sorry?
Your name? Yes, I thought so. Yes. When'd you get your act together in school? When'd you get your act together in school?
Sophomore in college.
Thank you. You, sir. Yes?
I think it's
going to
be by New Year's resolution.
No, come on. You got your act together. When do you think it happened? Andrew, when did you get your act together in school? When did you become that organized, focused, do all your homework kind of guy?
About 18
or 19 years old. You, sir? Ninth or 10th grade. And you, sir? Graduate school. You were how old? Your 30s. Tell me your name. Mark, why did you finally get your act together?
Because
I was paying for my own graduate school. You can't imagine how many. Now, the moms are sitting here thinking, oh, no. Oh, no. Oh, no. Because I know if I go down a row of women, I'll say, when'd you get your act together in school? And they say, fourth grade, fifth grade, fourth grade, sixth grade, kindergarten. I was always that way, right? And that's why the gods sent you a boy. Right? If you weren't raised with brothers and you got three boys, it was so you could get the complete course. And see school through the eyes of boys. Look, the issues that confront those of us who advocate for boys, and to me it's astonishing that I'm a boy expert. I was a feminist-inspired psychologist. I went through graduate school I missed you. I missed you, sir. Tell me your name. When did you get your act together? 10th grade. So that's our range, 9th grade. To early 30s. I wrote my doctoral dissertation on anorexia nervosa, and I believe very strongly that society was driving girls crazy about their bodies, making them hate their bodies, essentially driving them into mental illness. And I stand by it. 80% of 14-year-old girls in the United States have already dieted, worried that their bodies are not acceptable, that their hips are too big, their thighs are too big, and they drive themselves crazy, and it puts them at risk. It does put them at risk. But the idea that society is only hard on girls and is easy for boys is, of course, absurd. There are ways in which, if you can think of a four-cell square here, right, with four cells, there are ways in which society is very, very punishing towards girls, and ways in which society is very kind and forgiving towards girls, and there are ways that society is very punishing towards boys, and ways in which it's very forgiving for boys. And girls and boys have to navigate that, and I ended up an advocate for boys because I went to work as a school psychologist, and most of the referrals to a school psychologist are boys. There are many more depressed boys before the age of 10 than there are depressed girls. There are many more boys with learning issues because the boy brain is more variable than the girl brain. When in the fetal life of you know, in the life of every fetus, the default fetus is female. You aware of that? And it has to be an introduction of androgens, which turns the body of a fetus into a male, and also then means the boy is going to be more active, more restless, more physically active, and follow an entirely different arc of growth and development than our girls. Well, you think if it's a totally different arc, well, then we should go back to having only schools that have, you know, single-sex schools.